And the Director General of Post and IT Implementation, Mr. Ahmad Ramli, the Honorable Guest, Ladies and Gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, we are gathered here on this very fine morning to present at the General Lecture, which will be delivered by the Secretary General of ITU, Mr. He Lin Zhao. Today's proceedings are as follows. First, short remarks from the Minister, the General Lecture from Mr. He Lin Zhao, questions and answers from the guests, souvenir photo group, and will be ended by press conference. Now, I'd like to request the honor of the Minister of Communication and Information Technology, Mr. Rudy Antara, for short remarks. Please proceed to the stage. Thank you.
My brother, Mr. He Lin Zhao, Secretary General of ITU. I consider him my brother because our relationship is not only a formal relationship between the ministers and Secretary General. So we keep exchanging the views and sometimes on the phone calls and most of the things through WhatsApp. Even the agenda for his visit, we decide between both of us without involvement our assistance. And then we have here as well the stakeholders of, I call it stakeholders of the ICT of Indonesia. We have representative from MASTEL, our Indonesian ICT society, represented by chairman who are sitting on your left side. And then we have, we call it some sort of independent regulatory body, but not really independent because they are still part of the ministry, you know, but could act as independent regulatory body. We have representatives who can, I can represent in the interest of the internet. Yeah. We have Pandi, here we are, Pak Jiwa Tampu. You must know Mr. Olin very well. We have also people who can represent the cyber security interest in this country. And we have Adi Suteja, and Pak Rusdi. I think you can introduce yourself later on, because too many people there in this room. Mr. Secretary General, as we just came from Davos, both of us, the issue in Davos was how can we connect the other 3.5 billion people in the world who are not connected yet. In Indonesia, we have 262 million people, yeah, but we do not know yet how many are connected already. We know, but only less than 20 million people connected by fixed broadband. But through mobile broadband, some say 300 million, which is more than our own populations. But we will know the result, I think, by end of February, once upon the completions of our prepaid registrations. That is still the main issue. How can we connect the unconnected people, counted for the 3.5 billion throughout the world? And as I shared with Secretary General this morning, that Indonesia have very clear program, very clear policy, and very clear direction how we will connect our own people. Yeah. Upon the completions of Palaparing by 2019, that the whole region of the company, throughout the country, will have the broadband connectivity, backbone broadband connectivity, then we would like to use this one as an incentive for operators to develop more access into the more remote area. And I have shared as well with Secretary General that this year we'll make decisions on our own hydrogen satellite. Indonesia, we have 262,000 schools, starting from elementary schools, junior high schools, senior high schools, where around more than 80,000 schools are not connected through internet yet. We have more than 10,000 villages hospital where the 3,000 are not connected yet. How are you going to connect this one? How are you going to connect the internet to the schools? We connect the, for some schools, they have connection to the internet, but they're using internet for, they're using computers, ICT, but only for examinations. The country visions is internet to be used for the study of the students. Yeah. In Indonesia, we said probably three or four, the way we conduct the strategy for learning, it has to be changed. In the near future, once we have infrastructures in place, the students, probably the three or four students form a group, and the schools provide some sort of cases. And the solution has to be found, has to be structured by the students, by the group of students, by using internet. It's not the end solution, but an approach that will make Indonesia difference in 10, 20 years down the road. Once we have infrastructures, once we change our mindset, once we change our approach in studying, then that will change Indonesia significantly. Mr. Secretary General, I wish that this morning sessions will give benefit not only to us, to Indonesia, that you can share what is the strategy on the IPU in addressing the 3.5 billion, the unconnected ones, yeah? And, but also this will benefit to IPU and to us. I have shared this morning, early morning with Mrs. Secretary General that Indonesia is intended to keep his seat. It sits in the councils as the member councils during the upcoming planning vote by end of this year. By this, I would like to conclude my remarks. Then I would like to hand it over directly to Mr. Secretary General to share his thought and give lectures to us, give lessons to us, to the stakeholders of ICT in Indonesia. Mr. Colin, this is not coming only from the ministry, and I think more than 50% audiences are not the ministry or not ministry peoples. That's the way we would like to conduct the, or implement the policy we have taken in the ICT sector in this country. Government hand in hand with the stakeholders. Government hand in hand with the CSO. Government hand in hand with the NGO. Government hand in hand with the market, with the people. And of course, we still have a brain here like Pak Jiwa Tampu, yeah, that has been served the IPU for a couple of years in the past as well, that may contribute to the country. Again, thank you very much. Mr. Hollins, stage is yours. Thank you.
Your Excellency, Mr. Fuller, CIT, Mr. Buyantara, and dear colleagues, it's a great pleasure for me to come here to visit Indonesia. Indeed, Minister take me as his present, and we fixed this visit last week. Also, we talked about this visit already for some time. I think last time was when we had our ASEAN Minister meetings in Cambodia. November last year, and he asked me again when you come to Indonesia. Because I told Excellency that my first visit to Indonesia was in 1992, when I was a tourist with my wife and my son visited Bali. That was my first visit. Then after that, I visited Indonesia several times. Officially, I think that the first visit was also for me in Bali. Yeah, 2000, when IDU had our regional preparation meeting for WTGC in 2000. And then afterwards I visited Indonesia several times. But the last visit to Indonesia was the year 2008, July. I came here for a short visit.
I came here this morning with some surprise that I prepared a speech. And Mr. told me that this is a family environment and you don't need to do it, but to read your text. So I will put it aside. Okay, okay, I have my speech again. I was very pleased to see this room full of people from different parts. But the first impression when I get into the room, I found that this room is very clever. Not only because we have so many lady participants, but also, I think man is also very clever. But your man's clothes is not clothes normally we can see for man in any other places. And very clever clothes, and of course I see a lot of lady participants, because even Europe or in ITU, when we had the meetings, we want to add ladies for our photos. We said we should have ladies for our color, because otherwise it will be one color, and it's not good. And here I think that we don't worry about this kind of color, because in the main also we are very colorful clothes. I think that Indonesia has done a wonderful job over recent years. We see, as I just mentioned, that mobile penetration is already more than 300 million. According to IT statistics, about 150%. We have 250 people, more than 300 million mobile phones. It's a wonderful development. It's my belief. If 10 years ago people talked about the Chinese market, Chinese development, Chinese expense, seems to be quite popular in the Asian development, Chinese, for example. Then after Chinese market, we talked about the India market. India also developed very rapidly. But then I already strongly believe that after Chinese market, after India's market, it's even Indonesia's market. Because as far as population is concerned, you are one of the biggest populated countries in the world. As far as economic power, economic development is concerned, you are in the very special dynamic area, ASEAN area, and you have a very good environment to develop yourself and also to help ASEAN economy to be developed. But also, I think that you have talented people. You have a lot of dynamic, educated young people here. And, I believe this is something that the future of our country is. But also I know that your government has a very, very, very good strategy to focus on ICT for transforming Indonesia. Particularly our minister is not only very energetic, you know, that, but I discovered this morning during my discussion with him that they're very, very clever, very, very wise, and very, very visionary. We talked about the universal access phone everywhere in the world. We still have this phone available to our market, but not everywhere we can use the universal phone right away or in strategic manners. Why up here? You know that the government put part of these universal funds together with the public funds to develop this, we call it Palapa Ring project. And I asked him, you know, that the Palapa Ring project seems to be very ambitious to connect more than 500 regions very soon. Next year we should see this project completed and put in service. So to connect more than 500 regions of Indonesia, which is the largest island country in the world, more than 1,700 islands. It's not easy. I asked him where you get money. And he told me he has no problem with the money. Because he can use the universal fund. But it's not enough. We also convinced the president to assign some public funds to support this project. But also, when you have money, how can you put the money into the project to connect the regions? I asked the further, then you have submarine cables that connect the island to the submarine cables. So you think that is easy, then you do something on the land. And he said, yes, we got full support from his government, from president, but also from other ministries. That is great. But again, he talked about public-private partnership. It's a very problem that the Indonesian government put this ministry as a reference for PPP. That is, I think, absolutely a correct approach. Because today, I can tell you, ITU, we have statistics, and we consider that today still more than 3.9 people not connected online yet. And a similar group has not used mobile broadband yet. And how can we bring the benefit to these people? While in the same period, we have to bring the latest technologies, such as 4G, 5G, Internet of Things, smart cities, to the users already in service. And you have to bring them with the new technology, new services, you need investment. But then to connect the others not connected yet, we have to make additional efforts to connect them. And we at the ITU and also United Nations, we have some statistics that to connect 1.5 people online from not online yet to online, we need at least $450 billion. That is economist research. But industry consider that is not enough, it's shocking. $450 billion to connect 1.5 billion people new online by 2020. We cannot make it. So we need more. But when I talked to the chairman of World Bank, and he told me that he has no money, because this is not on his agenda. It's from ICT side, it's from the others. So you don't have money from this financial institution, banks. On the other hand, we need money. We need investment. Why we need investment? Because we have to extend our infrastructure. There's the only way to use public-private partnership. So over the last 3 years, as a civil general of ITU, which you know, this is the only specialized agency in the UN system responsible for ICT. So my main message I shared with the head of states and head of government. And in my office, I have a collection of my photos with the president of member states and all prime ministers. Covers from developing countries to developing countries. Your ambassador who went to my office last year want to see my photo with your president. I'm looking for opportunities this time to meet you with your president as well. So my message to this head of state, head of government is ICT is absolutely important tool to connect people, but also is a very important tool to facilitate the socio-economic development. As Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Guterres recently told us at our meeting that in his opinion, ICT is a very important tool to help us to achieve each and every SDG goals, 70 goals. Which means what? Which means without ICT, none of these goals could be achieved. So ICT is very important. And everywhere we talked about e-government, e-commerce, e-health, e-education. But this is all based on e, which means infrastructure, e-infrastructure. If we don't have e-infrastructure, we cannot do that. But this e-infrastructure still, unfortunately, not be beneficial to everybody. as I mentioned, half population not connected. Why we don't have enough money to do that job. So public and private partnership is absolutely important. But on the other hand, also it's the government responsibilities to create a good environment to attract the investment. So this morning, Minister repeated several times, it's government responsibilities. And he repeated this message at Davos. Right? Indeed, it's government responsibilities to create a good environment to attract the investment. But this is not easy for our government to do. If you look at the situation in the world, you will find in many countries, particularly from developing countries, they may not have a means to do that. But more important for me is sometimes they do not have this kind of visions to focus on the ICT to transform their economy. Rather, some government pushed ICT to contribute to the national GDP. So instead of invest in this area, they counted the income from this area. So nothing wrong to count on the income, but if we don't invest further, the gap between developed countries and developed countries will become bigger and bigger. Well, I'm very pleased to hear from our minister this morning, and I'm very pleased to see in Indonesia this gap is getting very rapidly shrunk. And the minister has a very ambitious mission and a vision that within the next 1 or 2 years, Indonesia become number 2 in the ASEAN regions as far as the infrastructure is concerned. I think that is absolutely important. If the leaders of the ICT at the national level does not have a clear vision, does not have a clear plan, then you will not see the country will be developed so quickly. And if a minister already have such kind of clear vision, and if a minister convinced the government, I heard from the minister this morning, the president will fully support him. And if the other ministry of the same government cooperated with him, I think that his vision will become true very soon. So it's very good opportunities for Indonesia to see their next development, reform, and we not repeat the same economic development, the same historic development many countries experienced to now. So I just asked the minister permission this morning. Since I am going to see continuously to see the head of state, head of government, continue to convey my message to them, to ask them to support ICT. So can I use the Indonesia as a good reference? And he said yes. I think that this is indeed a good example for me. And during my discussions with head of state and government over the last 3 years, I found another program for us, challenge for us. That is this misperception that ICT is a very good economy, ecosystem. ICT business is always a profit-making business. ICT business is always self-sustainable. That is part of the reason why some authorities do not really put the ICT in the priority. That is why in many developing countries, the Ministry of Communications quite often will not get much attention from financial ministry when they have their financial assignment of their budget. Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Education, Ministry of Health, Ministry covering energy or transport normally can get a lot of financial budget from the Ministry of Finance, or your Ministry of Communications do not have such kind of activities. As I mentioned, some countries, they even counted the Ministry of Communications
its financial contribution to the national GDPs. They take money from the education. So this kind of public perceptions, you know, that I try to also share with the head of state, the head of government. I'm very pleased to get quite a positive answers from high authorities. I invited them to go to the United Nations when they come to deliver their messages to include their support for ICT development in their country. Many of them promised, and I'm very pleased to see some of them already delivered that message in their public speech at the United Nations. So environment is not that bad for ICT. Of course, ICT today is not anymore relying on telecommunication. ICT is also very dynamic for everyone. In particular, that I think that the SMEs, small medium-sized entrepreneurs, contribute a lot to ICT development. I think that my first meeting with our minister, I think 2014, I still remember that. He taught me that his ministry is run the Ministry of Telecommunications as such, and he spent more than 70% of his time to prepare for the other part of the ICT industry. I think he's correct, he's right. Today, the telecom is still infrastructure invested by telecom operators, but applications, connections, solutions, many SMEs contribute a lot. Because our SMEs know local community. They have new technologies, they know the market, they are eager to contribute to their national economy, they are eager to bring the benefit of telecom, 4G, big data, internet things, all these new technologies beneficial to their local community. So they develop their own applications. And ITU was created in 1865. And we celebrated our 150th anniversary in 2015. But over more than 150 years long, we worked with big companies. We are very proud. We are the unique UN family members. We have industries, our sector members. No other UN family members as private sector as their members. We have more than 800 industries as our sector members, including the latest one from Google, Facebook, Alibaba, and the others. And also, as some of you know, that we have universities as our academy members. Today we have more than 60 universities. By the way, I'd like to also invite a university from Indonesia to join us. We have not got anyone. Why we already have quite a number from the region, from Asian members. So we have to have. Because the university has a strong research capacity. They also have very good development capacities. And they could help to develop a national market. But in the future, we also count SMEs, universities to help us to develop world technologies of communication. For example, 5G, we are still working on 5G. And IT, we are finalizing the spectrum issues and technology details next year, 2019. So we are encouraging our sector members, big companies, active companies, but also we are encouraging our SMEs to contribute to this process of standardization of 5G. And by the way, next year IT will organize the next radio conference, which will be held in Xiamen for Egypt in October, where we will finalize our 5G. And next year, I noted that it's also 7 years anniversary. Indonesia joined ITU. So we might find opportunity to celebrate the 7 years cooperation between Indonesia and ITU. The minister just expressed his desire to see Indonesia to become IPU council member to be elected October this year. I fully support your candidate, and I'm also very confident you will be re-elected. But the minister told me that nothing is granted, you have to work hard. So that is the game for the minister, that I'm very serious with the business. I still remember a happy moment at our Green Invitation Conference 2010. Indonesia was elected as a council member from the Asia Pacific region as number one of 13. You have left a special instrument, music instrument. And who are the people who just echo that music? I think you remember that very well. So I'm very confident. But anyhow, the minister said that he will work hard to make sure that Indonesia will be re-elected this time. Nothing is re-elected, I can tell you. Last time, 2014, Indonesia was re-elected after 2010 successful surveys.
But it was the same place.
Our good friend, very good neighbors, Malaysia, unfortunately was not there. Malaysia was in the council for many years, and for some reasons, maybe everybody considers that Malaysia will be elected, so that they don't really seriously consider that there will be a risk, so that they give vote to the others, and then finally, Malaysia just missed one vote and lost the opportunity. So this is something that we really appreciate. Not only has a strategic visions, but also very serious as a business. Let me come back to the SMEs. SMEs, you know, IT would like to work with SMEs. So that starting from 2015, you know, I convinced my leadership of ITU to transform ITU platform of Telegram from its focus on the telecom operators to come to our platform to show their services and equipment, technologies. Now moving to focusing on ICT SMEs. And we now each year organize this telecom, this focusing on SMEs, try to provide them platform to have a partnership, share expenses, share their challenges, and encourage the government to support SMEs. We had very good participation from Africa, from Arabic, also from our Asia. And we had a lot of SMEs brought in by their authorities. But the first 2015 and 2016, I did not have Indonesia. I talked with the minister. I said, "Will you help me?" So in 2016, the minister told me that in Indonesia, SMEs is managed by another ministry. And he helped me to write to that ministry to invite them. But finally, I did not help them. So in 2017, I invited the minister again to organize SMEs to join us. And he himself came with very strong participation of SMEs. I understand more than 11 SMEs come to join at our telecom 2017 in Busan. At our telecom event, we conducted some competitions to award those excellent projects developed by SMEs. I think that as the meeting, minister was also very serious, and he followed the competition because it's an open competition. And there's nothing pre-cooked. So he was there from beginning until the end. Finally, we got very good. It's not because he was there, because many other ministers are there as well. But our Indonesia project, Modaku, was awarded an excellent project. It's not a strange to us, because the same year, last year, in June, we organized a Wishes Forum. And this forum is the forum jointly organized by ITU together with the UNESCO, UNCTAD, and the UNDP. And last year, as we did before, we also opened competition for projects. Last year alone, we got 500 projects presented to competition. 500. We had 300,000 people voted more than 1.1 million votes. But as far as the individual concerned, that means 300,000 people participated in the voting. And there, three Indonesia projects were awarded. I think that the project CSO, my friend just told me it was him. That is what do we call it, that CIHA. Yeah, Internet ICT Watch project was awarded as a prize owner. And we had another two projects. I think the PT Telecom Indonesia 8 villages. That is for farmers. And another one, I think that is from one entrepreneur for what is called the fact for radio stations. Huh? That one is quite famous with its function to monitoring or even predicting the natural disasters of tsunami and volcanic eruptions. So among 500 projects, three of Indonesia projects was included or finalists. We only got less than 50. So there's a lot of talent, SMEs, in Indonesia. And of course, today, everywhere you see very brilliant young entrepreneurs and very dynamic in the high tech park, innovation center, incubator centers. So we like to work with them. So once again, I'd like to invite Indonesia and the minister to come to join us this year. This year we will have a visit forum in Geneva from 19th to 23rd of March. It's somewhat irregular because in the past we only organized that in spring, but due to the reasons of Ramadan. So we revised this year a visit forum to be held in Geneva, March. Again, we will try to award those center projects. So I'd like to invite you to present your projects through that web consultation. And then later this year, in September, ITU will organize Telecom this annual event, invited by South Africa from 10 to 13th of September. And that meeting will be back-to-back with the BRICS ICT minister meetings. So we assume that this year we will have even bigger participation. And since this year's Telecom is the largest event of ITU activities before Plenary Architecture Conference, I also believe there will be some more activities, particularly for example, for the lobby for promotion of their candidate for different positions, candidate for council. So that could be another opportunity for Indonesia to lobby if you would like to take that profit of that event. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think that we noted the ICT development in the world, we noted the ICT development in the region. But we are very pleased to note the marvelous development of ICT in Indonesia. And together with our minister, I'm looking forward to see Indonesia become number two in the ASEAN regions. I'm also eager to see this ring project. Not only a ring project, but also satellite project and some other projects. This will bring a lot of benefit to our big population over 1,700 islands, which is unique. And this morning, Minister criticized ITU with this way of calculating the ranking that Indonesia's situation is somehow unique because you have so many islands, you are not the land-dominated countries. So that is absolutely reasonable criticisms that I think that I will take this message back to our team to ask them to say, but I'm very pleased to see that Indonesia experts will join that team to work on these topics. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think that I'm not expected to make such a so-called lecture, but anyhow, following the advice from the minister, I did not read my text. And also like to recognize one of my older friends and also one of the former ITU leader, Mr. Joe Tanuki. You know, ITU's new structure has three sectors: standardization sector, radio communicating sector, and development sector. And last year, development sector celebrated its 25th anniversary. We awarded a few loyal members. I think Indonesia Telecom was one of those loyal sector members from Asia Pacific regions. We just picked up Indonesia as a good example of this region. And at the presentation, we had all five directors from the very beginning, and the first director. This is Mr. Joe Tan. And I learned his nickname last time when I come here. Tachi. Pachi. I don't know whether this is a friend name or something, but anyway, I heard that this is some addressing his close friend to call him Pachi. I said, it's about Joe Tan. Why is it Pachi? But that anyway, this is culture and I'm very pleased to see him here. So last night I checked with my staff in the region. Yeah, I mean in Jakarta. I said, whether we can tell the temple. And he said, yes, sure. And also for your support to our unit and only area office. ITU area office for ASEAN, hosted by Indonesia, Jakarta. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think that this is my short message. Oh, yeah, you have to again. The question and answers, yes.
Yeah, sure. I think, Mr. Secretary General, since I'm the host of your visit right now, I have to say that. Your visit has to be provide some sort of benefit to Indonesia stakeholders, not to only to my ministry, but to audiences here as well. You know? So if you don't mind, we should take some sort of the Q&A. So there's been any concerns, questions, proposals, vetoes to the Secretary General. I think you might raise your hand. The Secretary General, there is no freelance under the sun. So even though we have plans, so against that the price paid is by responding to the questions or concerns raised by the audience. I see one from there, second from here, and then two. Silakan Pak.
It's alright. You know, this is
feast was really fixed when we together at Davos last Tuesday. I got my visa and a special assistant from the ministry, from the minister himself. I got a visa Friday afternoon, 4 o'clock. So nothing is pre-cooked. So that, he told me that there is a tradition that maybe you have to prepare to answer something. I said, it's my pleasure. Yes, please.
Just quick questions. Garen from Internet Society Indonesia here, Mr. Zhao. I've been assigned by ITU 2009 to design internet exchange at Afghanistan and those other countries. But my question now, chasing for the topic discussion today, actually you were mentioning about digital literacy as well as the other one, digital economy, and you haven't talked at all about it. So my question maybe is simple. Indonesia has a problem. We were ranked 60 out of 61 at literacy globally. So going to digital will be very hard. So giving your position as an ITU Secretary General, what is your suggestions to beef up this really gap on the knowledge of literacy itself? Not going to economy, you know, but literacy going to digital economy, so it's a big gap. So that's only my question. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think that this literacy is also one of the problems for us when we calculated the ranking of countries as far as ICT is concerned. And we know that those big populated countries like China, India, Indonesia, and the others, this literacy is somewhat affected their ranking positions. And this one is absolutely important for us. And I remember at our session last Tuesday, and we talked about today's coverage. And GSMA very proud that, for example, 3G coverage almost 94%. But when we talked about the usage, coverage is one thing, and the usage is another. The usage, we already noted, more than 3.9 people not online yet. And even for the mobile phones, that quite a big portion of our populations have not been able to use the smart functions. So this literacy is really an issue for us. I think that nowadays we have a lot of means to try to improve our situation. And I think that with more and more internet connections, that this kind of thing could be further improved. And we also focus on those populations where, relatively weak in this part, in particular women and girls. And we try to also to encourage our partners to help us to do that. So ITU is working with UNESCO, with the UN Women, to launch a campaign like, for example, we, together with the UN Women, launched Equals to invite our people to, our partners to pay attention to women's ICT capacity trainings. Not only for usage, but also for job creations. And we also work with our partners, like the big companies, Bill Gates Foundations, Microsoft, Intel, these big companies, to try to develop programs to training our populations. And of course, we also encourage small, medium-sized entrepreneurs to help us to find the local solutions to change the situation. And with Internet Society, you might have noted that ITU has very good cooperation with the Internet Society. Although in the past there's some political misperceptions or political tensions between ITU and ICANN, I'm very pleased to share with you that last May 2017, I invited ICANN board members to come to visit ITU. We had 3 hours discussions, and
had lunch invited here.
As you said, there is no free lunch.
That lunch had to further strengthen cooperation between ITU and ICA. So I was very pleased to be invited by ICA CEO and chairman of board to go to their meetings the end of October, so the 1st of October in Abu Dhabi, the board meetings. I was warmly welcome. With the International Society, we strengthened our cooperation to look at these kind of issues, particularly to find ways to improve connectivities with people in the remote area, in the poor area, and particularly those not connected yet. But for those, they should be able to be connected but not connected, and that issue is the issue, and we try to also work with them. And in Asia Pacific, we have APNIC corporations, and I think that the situation could be further improved by, again, Minister's strategy, the public or private partnership. So that, you know, if you have any proposals, if you have any, you know, ideas, and take Indonesia as a case and give us proposals, we would be very pleased to come to Indonesia to look at the opportunity to work together to see a complete development with good result. I think the minister is very supportive to this kind of partnership. And the way he invited you here is already a good sign that he will also join the force.
If I may to that question as well, Mr. Secretary General, the ministry admitted that if it is only the ministry, we won't be able to improve the digital literacy. No way at all. We won't be able to improve the people's ability to manage the content, to select the content. No way at all. It's far from reality. So that's why the ministry approach is to have the stakeholder approach. We involve the CSO, we involve the NGOs, we involve the any other government's organizations. Even we have an expert in the ministry, appointed as the expert in the ministry, we have from CSO. The more we have people who work together from various sectors, the better for this country. For the time being, we have only probably 4 or 5 the experts working for me, working for the ministry. We have Pak Doni, we have Ibu Sita, we have Evi. I think Evi has to be the appointment for her has to be signed this week as well. And we have a lot of people, and we need more people. And if we do it by ourselves, even though government has money, even though government has policy, it's far from our objective to improve the digital literacy without the involvement of the stakeholders.
Yeah. Minister, I think you mentioned the very important part, contacts. I think that the contacts, for example, this morning I discussed with Minister. And then I noted that during the discussion, he talked to his colleagues in local languages. I cannot understand at all. Which means that your local language content will be better developed by your people. And I don't believe you know, you could have counted on United States experts, Chinese experts, India experts to develop that for you. It's you. So it's a local community. It's, but you have a talented people here. You have a lot of young people, you know, eager to develop that kind of content.
First of all, I believe that SMEs will play a very important role. And without the local contents to increase the resources for people to access, then this city will not be improved that rapidly. So I think that once more again, I would very much like to see that our local SMEs join us.
Next.
Thank you very much for the invitation, Mr. Min Chow. My name is Tao Hikasan, and I'm from the Telecom Regulatory Body. And I happen also to be one of the vice chair of the IITB study group during this dynamic ceremony. So I think we met already sometimes. My question, not coming from that, it's about the new, the recent statement that data is the new oil, or the most valuable resource now is not oil anymore, it's the data. And we see the proof that the biggest companies now is not Exxon or Chevron, but Google, Facebook, Microsoft, and the like. So, but with careful observation, we see that the benefit of this data generation, for instance, USA is one of the biggest users of Facebook and Twitter. And even some of the study coming from the United States, it's always focused on how this data benefit the developed country. So I don't know if this suggestion or question, what is the IITB role, or how can you promote the IITB to make the benefit of data creation, data generation, is a stay or profit also the country where the data, where the data is generated. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. First, let me just recognize your contribution to IIT work when you join IIT activities. I would encourage our India expert, Indonesia experts to come to IIT activities in the future, like already you did in the past. We need you, of course. You know market here, you know what people like to have. Demand, a request, this to the IIT family. By the way,
if I may,
that is, nowadays compared with your North neighbors,
Indonesia is not that numbers in the
IIT study group activities from your participation. You see, today when we talked about the technologies, we talked about the so-called CJK. CJK means the Chinese expert, Japanese expert, and the Korean experts. Now these three countries now have their regular contact, try to harmonize. But I don't believe that is 100% Asia technology. This is only CJK's technology.
And if you don't have ASEAN members,
if you don't have Indonesia's, if you don't have India's, that is not Asia. So that just like in 1980s when Japan very strong development, the IT use of technology part, like the sanitation part, when they had any different opinions, different options, that might be three. One is from North America, actually it's Americans. One is from West Europe, that is. And then there is one from Asia, it's Japan. But then in 1980s, Korea came up, so that the Japan's position to represent Asia was challenged by Western experts who think that it's no longer Japanese solution will be considered as Asia, that they needed to get their opinion from Korea. So later on, 1990s, the Chinese came up. But today, still only this north part of Asia. That, so I would very much like to see this CJP change. So I would encourage Indonesia experts to come to this international platform more to balance your neighbor in the north and to also contribute to the world technology development. As far as the data is concerned, I think you are absolutely correct. And data is some kind of oil, and even more important than oil. And people already talked about that. If we could have some reading a war because of oil, or in the future might be in a bigger war because of oil. And sometimes in the future we might have a war with the data. And the data, you know, is a big issue for us now. The data, you know, we noted that recently many member states had their own consideration for the data. For example, some Europeans consider that the data center or the cloud for their country's market should be based in their territory, not be acceptable for them to see those big data centers for their national market be hosted by the other members. And as some members already mentioned to me that for those who manage those big data, they cannot satisfy the local requirement, then they should not be accepted to be operated in their market, even like to block their data. So this kind of issue will become more and more important for us. On the other hand, we see, no matter what kind of risks, dangers, concerns for this data, we see more and more data is created, and more important the data affect our life. So ITU now is working with big data. Big data is one of the topics of the standardization center. And also, you know, how to manage the data, there's a policy matters here. That policy matters sometimes is more complicated because engage in politics. So that is not that easy. But of course, we also know that nowadays, not only because the problems between the government and another government, but also between government and the private sectors. Because nowadays the data is collected as collected by the big companies like Apple, like Google, like Alibaba, like the others. And unfortunately, not everywhere in the world, any country can has that kind of power or capacity to do that job. And in this private data collected by big companies represent big concerns of many countries. So that issue is somewhat linked with cybersecurity, with privacy, with also efficiency. I think the ITU is working on this from several angles. From the standardization sector, we try to see how can we make best use of our data. That is under the big data technology development. But also, how can we create a good environment to make sure that the big data will not be abused, misused by private companies. I think many countries try to help to develop some kind of guidelines. But anyhow, that also caused some troubles because those big companies who are not binded with the national requirement. So that how can we you know, deal with this issue? One way to make sure that their operation will not affect the national security. On the other way, how can we protect the privacy? Because the privacy of the companies also is the key of their success. If they cannot make sure that the data they collected, their customers are not trusted, they will be in trouble in the market as well. So these kind of issues, I think that they're still relatively, in my opinion, some stage that the international family has not reached a point that we should all sit down together to look at this issue. Although this is already on the agenda of international conferences, but in my opinion, quite often we have a polarized debate at the international level rather than as a business dispute debate. And you could imagine when you come to a business debate, sometimes we could find a solution relatively easily. When you come to political debate, it's not easy to make a progress. And we have this situation, unfortunately, today. But anyhow, I'm very confident that this issue will become issue be addressed by more and more people, more and more authorities, and more stakeholders. So the situation will be improved. This is also related into so-called new frontier issues. The Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Guterres, like to put any new technologies as a new frontier issue, like artificial intelligence, like data interoperability in smart city. I know that Indonesia also has a good project for smart cities. You know, more, last night from the television, and I noted that from CNN or some other channels, they talked about this, the wrist watch that collected the training data that could be the source of leakage of military secret. So all this, you know, that you would see. It's a major challenge to us. But I think that we have to work on this. We will try to encourage all partners, stakeholders, to come to address this. Sometimes you cannot not avoid the political debate, but we should also try to focus on business so that we can facilitate this together before. Again, if you have any proposal, any ideas, please let us know to work this way.
Mr. Secretary General, teman-teman semua, I had a chance to lead the discussions between ASEAN and EU in Davos. Yeah. Because the EU would like to see the possibilities to have some sort of e-commerce transaction based on the blocks between EUs and ASEAN. I was there with the other 6-7 people from ASEAN, Nazir Razak of Malaysia, Tony Fernandez, and ministers from Myanmar, from Singapore as well. And one of the issues with regard to the data, Taufik, is on the privacy. EU already adopted within their regions, they will not allow to have the e-commerce transactions if the countries within the blocks do not have the data privacy laws protections. While in Indonesia, we are preparing, we have lobbied the parliament as well to incorporate our proposed data protections, personal data protection laws. In Indonesia, we call it Rencana Undang-Undang Perlindungan Data Pribadi. And that is one of the issues that we have to address. Even though, even in the ASEAN countries, not all even ASEAN countries even have this kind of thought. But I think Indonesia is considered, some of countries they have the laws already in place, but there is also a country that haven't had a thought on this one. Indonesia is not advanced, but it's not also inferior, I think, on this kind of thing. Jadi, antara blok Indonesia dan blok ASEAN dan blok EU. The commissioners of EU were represented the EU during that discussions. Teman-teman semua, Indonesia presence in the Davos this time, our sectors attended the WEF. There are reasons. In Davos, we launched what we call is Digital ASEAN Initiatives. And WEF requested us to lead the Board of Governors. This is number one. Number two, they appointed us, me, myself, as the new member of the Board Governor of Stewardships on the Global Digitals. We have around 17 members, where four of them are coming from Asia, including myself, chairman of Hitachi, and then one's from UAE, and the other one, I think I forget from where. So we are discussing on the how we bring, because the WEF considered that Indonesia is really in the move of digitals. So that's why they requested us to come to Davos and to lead the Digital ASEAN Initiatives, as well as to be a member, the new member of Board of Governors Stewardships of the digital, of the global digitals. I think that's marked really our presence in Davos, where we have a lot of meetings. I think it's what's a good one. I never realized that it's very valuable having a presence in Davos.
You never been there?
I've never been there, to be frank with you. I always avoid Davos, to be frank with you. Why do I have to go to Davos? It's a teeny city, you know, it's very cold. There's snow everywhere, you know. But finally, I found it was very beneficial to us.
Yeah, I think that here, also I just add one point. I think Asia is a very good organization, very successful organization, very respected organization. And you may not fight yourself, but if you look at the situation here in Asia, Asia plus one, ASEAN plus one, ASEAN plus one, CJK plus one, then ASEAN plus another one, India, ASEAN plus, so that these neighbors could have problem among themselves, but you know, they are more respected as a group. And as a group also very much respected by European Union. And I think that it's quite good that whenever you know, we have some kind of progress from our ASEAN groups, I think that I would encourage it to go ahead. Like European Union. European Union, for example, cybersecurity, they have their own laws, they have their own, you know, idea. So I received the defense minister for Lithuania recently in my office, and he said that he's coordinator in European Union for cybersecurity, and he would like to see some kind of cooperation between Europe and ITU for this topic. So ASEAN, you know, we already signed agreement with ASEAN, you know, that's since 2012. So we'd like to strengthen our cooperation with ASEAN, and we also, as because I'm from Asia, that I have my natural feeling that if anything from ASEAN group could be possibly integrated into a group platform, that I would very much like to see that happen. But ASEAN could help us a lot. So you want to do?
You have already mentioned that data is not only the privacy but security, but the one is the sovereignty. We are talking about data localization. We have already the regulation on data localization. One is the mandatory or obligation to put data center in the country. So I think data privacy, security, luckily we have already the security agency, BSSN, just established. The third one is sovereignty. How we put that data belong to us, stay in our country. So, what do you think is that?
I think I'm not dictated that one. And that one, I think that is your sovereignty, that you could make such decisions. And even I encourage you to make that decision by your national parliament, the big conference will also prepare. Blame IT, you know, that is not your business. But of course, that here, that data security, data privacy is an absolute benefit for the people, for the country. And how can we, you know, work with big companies who own the technology to collect the data, to own the technology, to manage the data? I think that will be very important. But of that kind, if we, you develop your own data center, your data database, and you create your data cloud, you become stronger, and that you don't need to you know, to worry that much today. So that one, you know, I would very much encourage you to try to develop your own army here. For this one, I quite often share with my European friends. If you don't like the technologies in 1970, 1980s, you created your own technologies for balance the others. But nowadays, you know, seems to me that if you don't like that technologies, like OTT technologies, you don't have anything from your own side. That you have no strong position to argue with the others. So that to have good innovations, good in technology from your own market, there will be always most safe measures to secure your interest. But on the other way, you know, of course, as IQ international organizations, as I think we encourage global solutions, we encourage not
you know, to have too many different options that people may not be able to enjoy everything. So that one, that is another story. But on the other hand, with ICT development, we see many opportunities. So we encourage our industries, we encourage our member states to try to use the maximum of the ICT potentials to develop technologies beneficial to the people.
Well, thank you very much. Ada lagi pertanyaan? This is last. Okay, this is C.
I'm not hungry, I'm still waiting for some time to buy my food. Yes. Okay.
Thank you. My name is Dirgai Maresto. I am from Nusantara TV Digital. I want to talk about a transition TV analog to TV digital.
I understand that you already have good transition from analog to digital.
No, not yet. We are. This year we'll discuss and would like to amend or revise our law of broadcasting. That will incorporate the digitalization as well.
Okay, fine. So anyhow, we support that move from analog to digital.
I just want to know how the other country, how the process of migration from the other country. That we know 193. A country in the world is a member of ITU,
yeah.
And which the one you, did you think the best about a single mode, or multi mode operator to a digital platform?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Seem to me that you understand our technology, you understand our work very well. But according to ITU, we set up. June 2015 has a deadline to move from analog to digital for our region 1. Why we need that one? Because we need a spectrum to offer to other services such as mobile services. And by now I think that the European region has already successfully completed their digital transition. And some countries like Mexico, they had introduced that one in second half of 2015. Although they are not expected to go in line with Europe, but still, they planned that. But in the middle of the transition, the government, some of their politicians asked them to stop, because during that transition period, some analog television channel cannot be received by villagers, and then that politician worried about their votes, so that can ask them if they can just stop. They just came to ITU and asked me what they would refer to us. I said, if you have not started, then maybe you could somehow deal with the wait for some months. But if you already started, I think that you should not stop. If you stop, you get more trouble rather than you solve the problem. So I was very pleased to finally that Mexico also completed their transition in 2015. And I selected 2016 is almost there. And now we have a problem in Africa. And Africa is supposed to be covered by our satellite signals, the same as for Europe. That we put Africa and Europe in the same zone. And we expected to have the same time to transit from one from analog to digital. But unfortunately, realistically, they have not reached that point. Some of them still plan to do that, which means they have not started. Some of them already started, but they're not completed. So that will take some time. Because to transit from analog to digital, not be that kind of easy that you just change the television broadcasting stations. You also have to make sure that the people with their receivers, they also work with them, in particular with television, that their box should be offered safe. The government made a great effort to get people to change that.
still a struggle for that one.
So that is somewhat not 100% completed.
So if Indonesia is on the way,
and I would understand the issue, but I would also encourage Indonesia to speed up if possible to complete this first sport so that we can have analogous spectrum assigned to the European services.
Well, Mr. Secretary General, thank you for this valuable communications. That you also have shared your ideas, issues, and strategy, and you also hopefully may absorb the concerns, the issues that are available in Indonesia. And by this, I think I would like to conclude the not presentations, but quote-unquote called lectures from Secretary General Hu Lintao by inviting all of you to give an applause to Mr. Hu Lintao. Again, thank you very much. Then I would like to hand over the stage to Master of Ceremony.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Now I would like to request the honor of Mr. Rudiantara for token of appreciation and Mr. Hu Lintao to please proceed to the stage. Thank you. Thank you, Your Excellency. Now I would like to ask for Mr. Hu Lintao, Mr. Rudiantara, Bapak Ahmad Ramli, Ibu Farida, and Bapak Basuki to have their picture taken in the stage. Thank you. and gentlemen, please proceed to the stage. Yeah.